I'd like to read from John chapter 6. If you have your Bibles, please turn to John chapter 6. The main thought that's on my heart tonight is that we need to know what God's will is for our lives. Every time we come into the house of God, as we pray, we say, "Thy will be done." And that certainly is very important that we say that, because Jesus taught us to say that. We always need to be reconciled to whatever God's will is in our lives. We need to pray like Jesus did when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he prayed fervently, "Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine." So we need to pray for God's will to be done. And then there are a lot of times in our lives that we need to know a particular direction to go in our lives. It may be choosing a job, or it may be choosing a wife or a husband, or a lot of different things that we have to make decisions that you can't turn to a scripture and says, "This is who you're supposed to marry." But I'll tell you, I believe with all of my heart that God will teach you who you should marry. He will lead you to the one you should marry. God's will is perfect. Amen. We always need to pray, "Thy will be done." And we always need to be seeking God's will in our lives. We need to be praying for God to show us what his will is. I would caution you that sometimes the people of God think that God has told them what his will is, and actually the devil has spoken to them instead of God. The most positive way that you will always be able to know what God's will is in your life is if you're already doing the will of God that's expressed in his holy word. This is the written will of God, the commandments and the teachings of God. It's the will of God that you keep those commandments. And as you are keeping those commandments and reading and studying the word of God, God will show you what you should and shouldn't be doing. That's the will of God. David makes this statement in Psalm 40 and verse 8, I believe. He said, "I delight to do thy will, O God." He was glad to do the will of God. "I delight to do thy will, O God." And then he says, "And thy laws are written in my heart." You see, he's connecting doing the will of God with keeping the commandments of God. "I delight to do thy will, O God, and thy commandments are written in my heart." We need to learn, memorize the word of God. We need to know what the commandments of God are. The word of God says the whole duty of man is to fear God and keep his commandments. That's the will of God for all of us. I want us to look tonight in the beginning about Jesus making a statement about the will of God in John chapter 6, beginning in verse 37. John chapter 6, beginning in verse 37, reading through verse 40. The word of God says, and this is Jesus saying, "All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. For I came down from heaven," listen carefully to the wording now, "for I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me." Now, I believe that Jesus is speaking as a man here. Jesus, who is God manifest in the flesh, Jesus, the Son of God, his will and the Father's will were the same. But as a man, Jesus sometimes, like when he was praying for that cup to pass from him, he was praying as a man would pray. But he said, "Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." But in verse 38, Jesus says, "I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day." That's the will of the Father. Did you know that every single one that was given to Jesus Christ, every one of them is going to be raised in the last day? Amen. Verse 40 goes further about the will of God that Jesus is speaking about here. In John chapter 6 and verse 40 says, "And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day." So that's the Father's will about eternal salvation. It's the Father's will, Jesus said, that of all that the Father hath given me, I should lose nothing, but would raise it up again at the last day. So in the final resurrection, there's going to be a people so great that no man can number, out of every nation, kindred, tongue, family, and tribe, that's going to be raised and lifted up. We're going to be conformed to the image of the Son of God, and we're going to be taken home to be with the Lord forever. That's the will of God, and nothing can stop the will of God. When God has decreed something is going to happen, it's going to happen. It's going to happen exactly the way God says it's going to happen. It's going to happen exactly when God says it's going to happen. So we have the privilege of knowing something about the final resurrection, because this is the Father's will, that of all which were given to Christ Jesus, that he would lose nothing but would raise it up again at the last day. Now come down in your Bibles to John chapter 7. John chapter 7, verses 16 and 17. John chapter 7, verses 16 and 17. The scripture says, "Jesus answered them and said, My doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me. If any man will do his will," if you do the will of God, "if any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself." Brethren, the people of God can know the doctrine and know the truth of God if they're doing the will of God. It says, if you're doing my will, every man that does the will of God, he will know the doctrine, and he'll be able to distinguish between the doctrines of God and the doctrines of men. There are many doctrines in the world today, many beliefs in the world today. But we need to pray that God will help us to know what is the true doctrine, what is the true teaching of Jesus Christ. And the only way you can ever know that is by reading and studying the Word of God. That is the will of God. That is the expressed will of God. Now turn in your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 4, right toward the end of the New Testament. I want us to look at some of the specific things that the Word of God says. Now this is God's will for you. This is something you need to do. This is something God has decreed you're supposed to be doing. And if you ever want to know what God's will is in other matters in your life, you must be doing the will of God that's expressed in His Holy Word. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. The Word of God says, "For as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind." What's he saying in the beginning of that verse? What did Jesus do for us? It's expressed here. He suffered for us. And the Bible says all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Are we willing to suffer persecution? That's part of the will of God. That was part of the will of God for Jesus, and that's part of the will of God for us, is that we be willing to suffer. So he says, "For as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind, for he that suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lust of men, but to the will of God." We as a people of God, we need to live the rest of our lives wanting to do and doing the will of God. Wanting to know, God, what is your will? Teach me your will. Show me your will. Teach me your word. Teach me to read and study your word so that I can know what the doctrine is. Teach me to read and study the word of God so I can teach the doctrine or the truth to other people. Come down to verse 19, still in 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 19. He's still talking about suffering. That's what he begins this chapter with. In fact, chapters 2, 3, and 4. You go on and read 1 Peter chapters 2, 3, and 4. That's the subject in every one of those chapters, is the responsibility of the people of God to be willing to suffer for Christ's sake. That's the will of God, that we suffer. It was the will of God that Christ would suffer. And it's the will of God that once we know Christ, that we should no longer live in the ways of the world, but we should follow the will of God, which would include suffering for Christ's sake. Come down now to 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 19. For wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God. Is it God's will that we suffer? Listen, brethren, sometimes I hear people say, God doesn't want anybody to suffer. David makes this expression. He says, it is good for me that I have been afflicted, because then I learn thy statutes. When I am afflicted and troubled and my heart is heavy, and when I'm sad and when I'm suffering, I'm drawn closer to God, and I know God better then than any other time in my life. We need to pray, God, help us to be willing to suffer. Help us to do the will of God. Wherefore, let them that suffer, verse 19, wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to Him in well-doing as unto a faithful Creator. Brethren, God is our Creator, He is our Father, and we can trust Him, and whatever suffering we have to go through, it's the will of God that we suffer. Now, Peter also makes it plain that it is important that you suffer in 1 Peter 3 and verse 17. He says, it is better, if the will of God be so, that ye suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. Amen. Now, brethren, God has taught us that we're not to do evil. And when we as children of God, who are redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, when we do evil, we're going to suffer at the hand of God, and nobody can relieve us of that pain that we feel when we're suffering under the hand of God. But when we're following the word of God and keeping the commandments of God, and suffering and persecution comes from men, God will give you peace that will pass all understanding. God loves us, and He loves us with an everlasting love. Go back up one page in 1 Peter chapter 2, 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 15. Listen carefully. Here's part of the will of God. Now, what does 1 Peter 4, 1, 2, and 19, what do those three verses teach us? It's the will of God that we must fill in the blank. Suffer. It's the will of God that we must suffer. And when we say, thy will be done, we need to understand that we're saying, whatever your will is for my life, I'm willing to do whatever you say. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 15. The word of God says, for so is the will of God, that with well-doing ye may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. Now the word of God tells us here that you can put to silence the words of foolish men if you're willing to suffer for Christ's sake. And I pray that God will help us always to rejoice that God can shut up the mouths of foolish men when we're doing the will of God. And that's what Peter's telling us in 1 Peter 2:15. Now, what's another part of the will of God? Back up in your Bibles to Romans chapter 12. Here's the will of God. See, people come to me often. I get calls and people say, I'm not sure what God's will is. If somebody says that to you, if you're not sure what God's will is, the first thing you need to do is read and study the Word of God, because the Bible is full of the will of God for your life. And if you'll follow the will of God that is set forth in the Word of God, then God will guide you and lead you and bless you to know what His will is in all the decisions that you make in your lives. Have you ever made decisions that were outside the will of God? Have you ever gone in a direction contrary to what God would have you to go in? Have you ever made mistakes because you thought you were following the will of God and then found out later that was not at all the will of God? The only way you can stay out of that kind of trouble is every day be saying like David did, I delight to do thy will, O God. I want to do your will. Teach me your will. Help me to read your word so that I can know what your will is, the will of God for my life. Romans chapter 12 now, verses 1 and 2. Here's the will of God. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. The Word of God says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now, what's the will of God? In verse 1, what's the will of God?
Present your
bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And then verse 2, he says specifically that's the will of God. Verse 2, he says, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect. What are the last three words there?
Will of God.
What is that good and perfect and acceptable will of God? The only way you're going to know the will of God is if you're willing to do what verse 1 says and verse 2 says. If you're willing to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, that's doing the will of God. If you're not being conformed to this world, but you're being transformed by the renewing of your mind, you're being strengthened in the inner man, that's doing the will of God. And you'll know the perfect will of God when you do that. Go with me now to 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning with verse 1. I'm going to read about 7 verses here. And I encourage you to go home and read and study this passage that I'm reading to you, because it tells you a lot about the will of God. I want to know God's will. Teach me your will. Let me tell you something, brethren. I don't know what I'm going to do the rest of my life. You understand? I don't know what God's will is for the rest of my life. But I know if I follow God's word, God will show me what I cannot do and should not do, and he'll show me what I should do. And that's true of every one of us. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning with verse 1. Furthermore, then, we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that as ye have received of us how ye ought to walk and to please God, so ye would abound more and more. Is that the will of God, that you would walk and please God? How can you walk and please God? Walk in the light of his word. Walk in the straight and narrow way. And that's to please God. And do it more and more. Increase in your walk with God. Verse 2. For ye know what commandments we gave you by the Lord Jesus. What's the will of God? That you keep his commandments. Verse 3. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification, that ye should abstain from fornication, that every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor, not in the lust of concupiscence, even as the Gentiles, which know not God, that no man go beyond and defraud his brother in any matter, because that the Lord is the avenger of all such, as we also have forewarned you and testified, for God hath not called you unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. Brethren, that whole passage is just identifying one statement after another. It's the will of God that you abstain from fornication. It's the will of God that you live a life that honors and glorifies God every single day. Listen, brethren, if I'm doing the will of God, I'm not going to have to tell anybody I'm a Christian. It will show in our lives. People will see Christ in you if you're doing the will of God. And God will guide you in every other area of your life if you're doing the will of God as is described here. I know I'm going over this fast, but if you'll call me later, I'll be glad to give you a list of these scriptures and more scriptures that talk about us doing the will of God. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 18. The Word of God says, in everything, what are the next two words? Is that the will of God, that you give thanks to God? In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. How many times today have you been thanking God for the blessings you have today? The scripture says, the Lord daily loadeth us with benefits. Today, you and I have received so many blessings, we can't even count all the blessings we have. And it's a shame and a disgrace when God is blessing us in so many different ways if we're not, what's the two words that we're looking at here? Giving thanks. We need to be giving thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you, that you be giving thanks to God every day of your life. Back up two pages in your Bibles. Back up two pages to Colossians chapter 4 and listen to verse 12. This is one of the most beautiful verses in all the Bible. It's telling about a man that was a member of the church at Thessalonica, and yet at this particular time, he was with the Apostle Paul, traveling with Paul, working with Paul, laboring with Paul. The man's name was Epaphras. Epaphras. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 12. Epaphras, who is one of you. What's he saying to that church? He's one of your members. Epaphras, who is one of you. How many of you would have known all about Epaphras if I had asked you tonight when you first came in? All right, everybody write down everything about until this week, really studying and reading everything. There are 327 times in the Bible talks about the will of God. There's lots of places that we can look at the will of God. But this is one of the most beautiful in all the Bible. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ. Isn't that beautiful? Is that the will of God, that you be a servant of Christ? Amen. How can you be a servant of Christ? By serving other people. Pure religion and undefiled before the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction. We need to be doing good works to do the will of the Father. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluteth you, always laboring fervently for you. What's the next two words?
In prayers.
In prayers. Can't you just picture Paul and Epaphras kneeling down at night to pray? And Epaphras is in fervent prayer, praying for the saints at Thessalonica. Isn't that beautiful? He says, Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluteth you, always laboring fervently for you. What does the Bible tell you about effectual fervent prayers? They avail much. There was a lot of good things that happened to the church at Thessalonica because of this one member whose name was Epaphras, and even though he wasn't there with them, he was still praying fervently and laboring in prayer, praying fervently for them. And so he says, fervently for you in prayers, that ye may, listen carefully, that ye may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. What was Epaphras praying for? He was praying that the saints at Thessalonica would stand firm and steadfast in all the will of God. That's a great, beautiful blessing. I believe that in my life that there have been people, I know my mom and daddy and my grandparents, they prayed fervently for me that I would do the will of God. My wife prayed fervently. You have prayed fervently. We pray for one another, and we pray fervently one for another because we love one another. And we need to pray that God will help us all to be established to do the will of God in every way in our lives. Go to 1 John 2, and we'll close right here. This is right before Jude and Revelation, the very end of the New Testament. Look in your Bibles at 1 John chapter 2, beginning in verse 15. We need to pray, God, help me to do your will. Help me every day to know what your will is. Teach me your will. Help me to be glad to do your will. I delight to do thy will. 1 John chapter 2, listen, beginning in verse 15. 1 John chapter 2, here's the will of God. Love not the world. Do you ever love the world? Yes, I do sometimes. The Bible says, love not the world, neither things that are in the world. And sometimes I set my affections on the things of the world. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If I ever see any of you with a sign on your truck says, "I love my truck, I'm going to track you down and stop you." I thought it was a friend of mine with a sign like that on his truck, and I couldn't catch him, but I called him when I got home. I said, "Do you have a sign on your truck that says, 'I love my truck'?" And he said, "No, you know I know better than that." And he didn't. It wasn't him, but I thought it was. It looked like his truck and looked like him. Don't love the things of the world. Don't love the things of the world. Love God. Love the people of God. Love the Word of God. Love the church of God. Love to do the will of God. So he says in 1 John 2:15, "Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love this world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world." Do you know all sin falls into one of those three categories?
Amen.
The lust of the flesh, or the lust of the eyes, or the pride of life. All sin falls into one of those three categories. Now listen to verse 17 in closing. After he says, don't love the world and the things that are in the world, verse 17 says, "And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever." Isn't that beautiful? Forever. He that doeth the will of God abideth forever, liveth forever. I pray that God will help us to want to do his will, and to understand there are great blessings that come to the people of God when we do his will. And may the Lord help us to always know his will, is my prayer, for Christ's sake.